So this week we are going to be in our Jesus and Pottery study by reading the scripture. Our reading is from the Gospel according to Matthew, chapter 26, verses 1 through 16. And there's an insert in the bulletin, but you're going to follow. When Jesus had finished saying all these things, he said to his disciples, "You know that after 2 days the Passover is coming, and the Son of Man will be handed over to be crucified. Then the chief priests and the elders of the people gathered in the palace of the high priest, who was called Caiaphas, and they conspired to arrest Jesus by stealth and kill him. But they said, not during the festival, or there may be a riot among the people. Now while Jesus was at Bethany, in the house of Simon the leper, a woman came to him with an alabaster jar of very costly ointment. And she poured it on his head as he sat at the table. But when the disciples saw it, they were angry and said, 'Why this waste? For this ointment could have been sold for a large sum and the money given to the poor.' But Jesus, aware of this, said to them, 'Why do you trouble the woman? She has performed a good service for me. For you always have the poor with you, but you will not always have me. By pouring this ointment on my body, she has prepared me for burial. By pouring this ointment on my body, truly I tell you, whenever this good news is proclaimed in the whole world, what she has done will be told in remembrance of her.' Then one of the 12, who was called Judas Iscariot, went to the chief priest and said, 'What will you give me if I betray him to you?' They paid him 30 pieces of silver, and from that moment he began to look for an opportunity to betray him." This is the word of God.
Thanks be to God.
Back here in the fellowship
hall
for a new Lent.
Good, right?
Scary?
No.
So we're going to start off as we started off all of our work last year, setting some norms for the way that we want to interact as a group. A norm is an agreement about what is kind of acceptable behavior. There's a list of group norms on the wall back next to Glenn. Everyone look at Glenn. So here's what the norms are. Listen with an open heart. Try to put yourself in the other person's shoes when you're listening to someone who's telling a story about their life. The most difficult one in the world. Listen attentively and with love instead of planning what you're going to say next. It's really hard. Speak in terms of I, so say I think, or I feel, or in my experience. None of us are experts in this room, and certainly not in each other's lives. So staying with our own point of view, and remembering that it's only our own point of view. Things that are said in this room, what happens in the fellowship hall stays in the fellowship hall? Yeah. Okay. All right. If someone tells a personal story and you want to tell someone else, let's try to make sure that you get permission before you spread someone else's business around. Let's make sure that we keep things confidential. Assume that we all have good intentions. Can we assume that in this room? I think it's a pretty good intentioned bunch. If something that you hear is hurtful to you or you find it offensive, a good way we can deal with it is just to say, "Ouch." And that helps us all to know, ooh, something happened there, and we can finish whatever is going on, and then we can go back and say, David, what was so hurtful about what happened? Can you help us understand? It's a way to make sure that nobody's carrying a hurt inside that we don't know about. Speak loudly, so all can hear. We have a microphone this year, so that's hopefully helpful. But at the same time, if you can't hear, you need to let us know that you can't hear. We don't know you can't hear. That's, okay. And the last one, know yourself and know how you interact. So if you are an extrovert, if you grew up in a school where you were praised for participating a lot, you might want to hold yourself back a little bit. And if you are an introvert, if you were praised for being quiet and not sharing your ideas, if you need to think a little bit more before you speak, usually be aware of that and try to push yourself to speak up more, because we want to hear from everybody. Do those sound like good kind of ground rules? Is there anything that we should add or change? Okay, I see just some like nodding. Do we all, are we all going to agree to abide by these norms?
Yes.
Great, awesome. So we're not just going to launch into a totally new thing this year, but we're going to be building on the work that we did last year. So you remember the very first work that we did last Lent was on this kind of insider and outsider. Remember we did that exercise where we talked about, we told stories of times that we were insiders or that we were outsiders, and we made a list of how it felt and how we acted. We noticed that when we were on the inside, we felt good and powerful, and we spoke more, and we took charge. When we felt like we were on the outside, we often kept ourselves out of the group, or were quiet, or were afraid. And then we started to talk about the center and the borderlands in our own culture. So in the U.S. American culture, the center is what's considered normal. We talked about that, right? So it's white and male and heterosexual and married and owns a house, probably has money and education. It speaks English without a foreign accent, right? It was born in America. And then, of course, the things that are in the borderlands are the things that are not the center, right? So women or people with other sexual orientations or people of color or people without as much education or people without access to wealth or people with disabilities and all of these things. In all of these things, we saw ourselves in different ways, right? We're all kind of different levels of close or far from the center. We all have different parts of both of them, right? I have a master's degree. I have a lot of education, right? I'm married, I'm a white person. That puts me close to the center. But I'm also a woman, and that pushes me a little bit farther out, you know? So all of us exist in that kind of tension. You remember this?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Anything that you remember about what we did in our study last year that has stuck with you, I wonder?
To be more mindful.
Yeah, sorry.
To be more mindful of just when we address other people, to try to not necessarily be in their shoes, because that's pretty impossible, but at least be mindful of, you know, where they come from. You know, not just physically, but where they come from, you know, from, you know, their perspectives on life, their perspectives on so many different things. Not to impress ourselves upon them, but to let them present themselves.
I have definitely seen, it's not quite what you were talking about, but I have definitely seen individuals, especially in leadership roles in our church, become very conscious of when they're talking and when they're listening in a really cool way that's been like, oh, I've already been talking. I need, like, at session meetings, I think I need to be quiet and hear what you're saying. So that's also a cool skill that we'll learn.
You don't have it up there, but what I've carried with me ever since is wait.
Wait.
Why am I talking? And so I just
Why am I talking?
And I just learned to shut up.
That's good. Other things that you feel like you took with you out of what we did last year, Lisa?
When you said, I started a year ago.
Yeah,
right.
I can't believe
right.
You joined our church because you came to like
yes.
This event. Yeah.
But I remember you saying, assume everybody has good intentions, and I remember cringing because it's not what I've been used to.
Mm-hmm.
And I can feel completely different about that now,
wow.
At least here. And the fact that I'm speaking up right now when I would have never opened my mouth a year ago.
Yeah.
So.
Thank you. That's awesome. Other things that you remember that you took with you from what we did last year? I will remind you that our church did some work to publicly align ourselves. You remember the day we did the drawings about Jesus in the center and the borderlands and who Jesus was standing with? And Jesus was like definitely out here. And we thought about what it means to publicly align ourselves with the people who are out here, and we put that rainbow up on our sign. Remember that?
Mm-hmm.
was pretty cool. All right, good. So the reason, if you think back, that we did that study last year about racism is one, because our co-moderators of our national church, Jan and Tanya, wanted us as a church to be studying racism for the year. And it was also the 50th anniversary of the Confession of 1967. So you have a couple of folders on your table. There's not one for everyone. If you need more, you can go to other tables and get one. But will somebody open up to the Confession of 1967? I think it's purple. Yes. And get to section 9.4.
Enslaving poverty in a world of abundance is an intolerable violation of God's good creation. Because Jesus identified himself with the needy and exploited, the cause of the world's poor is the cause of his disciples. The church cannot condone poverty, whether it is the product of unjust social structures, exploitation of the defenseless, lack of national resources, absence of technological understanding, or rapid expansion of populations. The church calls all people to use their abilities, their possessions, and the fruits of technology as gifts entrusted to them by God for the maintenance of their families and the advancement of the common welfare. It encourages those forces in human society that raise hopes for better conditions and provide people with opportunity for a decent living. A church that is indifferent to poverty or evades responsibility in economic affairs, or is open to one social class only, or expects gratitude for its beneficence, makes a mockery of reconciliation and offers no acceptable worship to God.
I remember last year when we read that, we were kind of stunned by how clear and kind of cutting it was. We thought about how the work that we do to address poverty is often work that preserves the center. So we say, we have the stuff here. Let us with the stuff give the stuff to the people out here. But it does nothing to disrupt the system that's in action there. Because Jesus identified himself with the needy and exploited, the cause of the world's poor is the cause of his disciples. That feels pretty compelling. So that's part of why we're moving to talk about poverty this year. Our moderators, Jan and Tanya, who asked us to talk about race last year, are asking us all to talk about poverty this year as a national church. There are a couple of reasons I think that this is important, right? So this year, 2018, marks the 50th anniversary of the assassination of Martin Luther King Jr. And the last year of his life was marked by contention. He was not everybody's beloved soft teddy bear MLK that we like to remember, but he was somebody who caused some controversy. People were kind of speaking out against what he was saying. He was talking against the war in Vietnam. And he was bringing together poor folks of various races to advocate for economic justice. So this is a speech he did at the Riverside Church in 1967 called Beyond Vietnam, which after this, several newspapers put out articles against him and what they saw as harmful rhetoric. So here's what he says. We as a nation must undergo a radical revolution of values. We must rapidly begin the shift from a thing-oriented society to a person-oriented society. When machines and computers, profit motives, and property rights are considered more important than people, the giant triplets of racism, materialism, and militarism are incapable of being conquered. True compassion is more than flinging a coin to a beggar. It is not haphazard and superficial. It comes to see that an edifice which produces beggars needs restructuring. A true revolution of values will soon look uneasily on the glaring contrast of poverty and wealth. A nation that continues year after year to spend more money on military defense than on programs of social uplift is approaching a spiritual death. So this is some potentially contentious stuff, right? Some divisive stuff. And some things that we don't always remember. What we hear in his words is a critique of structural poverty, so not just this idea that some people are poor because it's their own fault, but that there is an edifice, he says, that produces beggars, right? That there's a system that makes it easier for some people to be poor and some people to not be poor, and that preserves that. And that's what we talked about with racism, if you remember. It wasn't just about, am I a racist in my heart? How do I feel? But it was about, what are the systems that we have in place that are preserving these distinctions between who is in and who is out, right? And our churches, our government, all of the institutions around us, businesses, can do things to preserve who has access and who doesn't. So King's really criticizing those structures. So that quote also was 51 years old, and not much has changed. In fact, I think you could say things have gotten worse. Did anybody hear about when the UN Special Rapporteur on Poverty came to the US? Did you hear about this? It happened in December. And he wrote this report. I will link to it online and you can read it. And here are some of the things that he found in this study. He visited California, he visited Appalachia, he visited Alabama, different places in our country to study what was happening with poor people. And so he says, by most indicators, the U.S. is one of the world's wealthiest countries. U.S. infant mortality rates in 2013 were the highest in the developed world. Tropical diseases like Zika are increasingly common in the U.S. It's been estimated that 12 million Americans live with a neglected parasitic infection. The 2017 report documents the prevalence of hookworm. Again, this was a chronic disease of poor people maybe a century ago that was a big deal in public health. It's coming back. In terms of access to water and sanitation, the U.S. ranks 36th in the world. America has the highest incarceration rate in the world. Youth poverty in the United States is the highest across developed countries, with 1/4 of youth living in poverty compared to less than 14% across the developed world. And the Stanford Center on Poverty characterizes the U.S. as a clear and constant outlier in the Child Poverty League. So U.S. child poverty rates are the highest among the 6 richest countries. Not great when the UN feels like it has to come to your country and investigate poverty. There's a paper on your table that has some statistics that looks like this about poverty in the United States. I'm wondering if you want to take a couple of minutes and look at some of those. You could even just pick one section and kind of look at those. And I'm just reading through a few of them. Just from whatever you've read so far, is anything surprising to you? Anything surprising to you? Okay, another question is, what doesn't surprise you? Or I like this phrasing, what feels familiar? So I'll go first. This one about only 48% of people could handle a $400 emergency expense without selling something or borrowing money. I feel like that feels very familiar to me. Are there other things that feel familiar?
I'm actually surprised it isn't higher.
Yeah. Well, half. That's half of the people.
Yeah. But even well-to-do people sometimes are way over.
Yeah, we're living beyond our means. Anything else that feels familiar to you?
The wage. I don't think it's the wage, but the value of the dollar that we as a working force, whoever we are, 20 years ago, if you were to look back at it, has not kept pace.
So wages have not kept pace with the cost of living.
Underemployment.
That feels very familiar to a lot of us, I think. Anything else about these statistics that you notice or that we should pay attention to?
Ethnic groups that aren't white are taking it on the chin pretty hard.
Not surprising to us, right? Because we're talking about who has access to the center. The farther we get from that, the harder everything is. What about kids? This is a church that really does a good job taking care of and inspiring and involving our kids. Is there anything in particular we should pay attention to about children?
The fourth bullet in the income section, at the second sentence, it says half of all children will qualify for food stamps before they turn 20, including 9 out of 10 African American children.
The thing that I take away from this is that something is wrong. Is that, are you with me? The first step is always admitting that you have a problem, right? I think we have a problem, and this feels like a good time to focus on it together. So Tanya and Jan, our moderators, have asked us to study poverty, and they've recommended a book to us. It's a little bit thick. It's written by a New Testament scholar named Liz Theo Harris, and it's called Always With Us, What Jesus Really Said About the Poor. I know last year after our study, one of the things we talked about in our feedback was that we wanted more grounding in scripture and study that related to our faith that way. So we're going to do a lot more focused in Bible study this year based on Liz's work. Liz and I were in seminary together. She's super smarty pants, and she organizes poor people and has worked with a lot of poor people's campaigns. She's so fascinating. She tells a story about when she went to the Committee on Preparation for Ministry in the ordination process, and they were like, Liz, you know, you're doing great work, you're doing all the steps that you need to do, this is awesome, but we just want you to know, if you finish this process and you still believe that poverty can be ended, we're not going to be able to ordain you.
Really?
Because Jesus said, you will always have the poor with you. And that's what really inspired her to write this book. Yeah. She says, every week someone says that to her. in this work. And she believes that not only can poverty be ended, but that we are called to do it. So with that very high bar set for us, I want to take a little bit of time, maybe 10 minutes, to just get into the scripture that we'll be studying this year.